Evening everyone, welcome to the Audit Disclosable Committee. Declarations of interest. Minutes. Not two sets. 17th September and 8th October. So we get by this one.
Similarly, on the value for money conclusion, although within the report itself, there are some recommendations around areas to sort of just look at and improve around some of the elements of that which management have responded to. And there are some management responses within Appendix A. Over on page 26, it just flags all the other areas we do around how we can use accounts, simplification of ground claims and returns, and we're currently in the middle of finishing some of the awards around that sort of housing benefit. And as you'll see from the fee page at the back, there is one of the claims we've done from the council this year on a regional growth fund which we've signed off and has gone off to biz. Very final page in Appendix B just sets out the sort of fees for all that work and sort of reports we've issued during the year. So I wasn't going to say a great deal more than that, Chair. Thank you for the introduction and just say I've been a pleasure working with Wirral over the last 7 years. I mean, as you already said, some challenging times, but I think at the end of it all, we've sort of come out still speaking to everybody and a respectful relationship on both sides. So, you know, I thank you, the new officers within the council, and wish the council the best for the future because things are not going to get any easier, I don't think. So, I wish you well.
Any questions?
This is a regular report that I present to members of the committee on a regular basis. It summarises the work within 10 hours service for the people from the 1st of August through to the 31st of October. The report concentrates on identifying items and notes for items that have been escalated from the regular reports you get from self-monthly reports. Provides some performance data relating to the internal service itself and identifying developments that we take to improve the service. Your attention is specifically drawn to section 2.2 of the report where a number of items and notes have been identified. The 2.2A I refer to some of the work that we've done on the key financial systems, and it is pleasing to note that the assurance of things provided for that work have a very positive nature. A number of small areas of improvement identified that have been discussed with managers and actions agreed to address those issues, but as I say, the opinions are good opinions on that indicate that the sort of decisions are now sort of in a situation where they're being well controlled. That's 2.2b, the commissioning, there's a piece of work that we were requested to do by the Institute. ongoing. However, the findings, the emergent findings today indicate that whilst there's no inference of any propriety against any past officer, there have been a number of examples identified which shows there are quite telling to come forth. And there are a number of nights where the council's conduct procedure has not been totally complied with. This report, as I say, is an ongoing piece of work. I know we're having discussions with officers with regards to sort of actions on how to address those issues. One of those actions would be that a report would be brought to this committee in January, identifying the issues and providing you with an action plan to sort of indicate how these officers are going to address those issues. Performance planning is the next issue that I might throw on to your attention. This was a review that we've undertaken of the performance planning and management system across the council. The findings of the review acknowledged the good work that we've undertaken by management since the previous review earlier in the year. There were no recommendations identified for high priority nature, but a number of us from low and medium risk nature that will be monitoring the sort of implementation of and will be reporting back to sales if we feel there's any problems or any issues with those. But overall, there is a positive picture, certainly following on from your recent review, where there were fairly significant number of issues and problems that we identified at the time. The third item that I want to bring to attention is in relation to a fraud awareness campaign that we recently ran. Rand Ware, who sits alongside is one of my teams, who actually sort of managed the delivery of that particular piece of work, and will spend a bit of time when I finish talking to you about what the exercise entailed and sort of the benefits that we have with sort of crew from that exercise. Finally, the last item in that particular section that I'm going to involve the information governance 2.2e. This is the submission that was provided to the Health and Social Care Information Centre regarding the information governance toolkit which the council has now submitted. We're waiting for assessment to be returned. They've already did some work to verify the actual submission itself. I'll be monitoring very carefully some of the actions that are arisen from that exercise. The toolkit has been an important catalyst for improving and embedding information governance throughout the authority. It's really important that we don't want to lose the sort of the emphasis that was getting through having to go through that exercise. I sort of bring this item to your attention purely to sort of flag it up and use some of the I personally, but we as a sort of body also need to sort of keep an eye on and make sure that this isn't lost. The Information Governance Board is operating on behalf of the organisation and is taking the lead in this area and will continue to ensure that sort of operational practice remains in place. In general, they have Seacombe that Information Governance Board table, so we have direct input to what is happening in relation to information governance. So it ideally places us really to be able to sort of bring this back to yourself in regards to sort of what is happening. If there are issues there, we flag them to the attention. If I could move on then to section 2.3, where your attention is drawn to table identifying information related to those audits where recommended actions at this precise moment in time haven't yet been implemented. The table is identified as an attachment to Appendix 1. All the recommendations you'll note are currently underrated, whether being in progress or about to be implemented within the timescales that we've laid down. You'll recall this is a regular Appendix that I give to yourself and identifies all those recommendations at any given time and that they're outstanding. It doesn't necessarily mean there's an issue or a problem with those recommendations. Most of them will sit within the timescales that we've agreed with management, which is why they're currently also rated down there. Should any of those slip beyond the agreed timescales or we have a problem with any of those sort of actions implemented, that's what they agree. I've been bringing to yourselves and we've flagged them to your attention. As I said, it's a precise amount of time, they're all operating, so it's good and positive. Section 2.4 identifies specific information relating to the performance of the internal audit service. You'll note at the moment, this precise amount of time, the services will be on target to deliver this sort of plan. Feedback from clients remains good, but all the key actions identified are reported to be reviewed and managed. And the satisfaction levels remain consistently high. The percentage of audit reports issued within 10 days of completion fieldwork remains a fairly challenging target that is directly affected by our ability and the ability of clients to discuss and sign contracts within a 2.5 report identifies some of the continued improvements that we've been making to the delivery service. You'll be familiar with some of this from the report to you, but these are improvements that we've made over the sort of 12 and getting them out and including our internal improvement plan. So what I would like to bring specifically to your attention though is the work that we've been doing to comply with the public sector internal audit standards. You may recall that the last week assessments of bringing the findings.
has relied upon truth and pride contract to the Labour Council, and they were setting up a similar contract that would get looked at with regard to 2.2 Bay. There's another contract, but it's a little bit of back in the borders. Jobs are causing material, I'm not sure if we. On that same page at the top, the credits was also before the district. In July sets an update for one of my recommendations being implemented on the 31st of October. In essence, it appears three duplicate payments were made. One of the recommendations there was for the reason why duplicate payments were made to be identified, not actions to be taken to advance it on the occurrence as well. I just wondered whether the
to
sort of like even if you like open if you will follow up. Now I appreciate your follow up is January 15th, but that doesn't you know, remove the fact that target date was set by rules that are clear what target date of 31st of October was set. I'm just wondering whether that target date is clear. I don't mind if you say, well, if the target date is set and it's the end of the year, which best in December, as long as everyone agrees it, but we're going to set a target date and then not really bother whether they get it or not. What we really want to set a target date was, you know.
You'll see from the actual report itself that the timescale is the there's a column there entitled timescale structure to chief director. That timescale is the timescale that we as internal audit laid out, we identified that. So this particular piece of work we identified December 2014 has been our target date for implementation. The section themselves came back with a date of October 2014. They felt it was something they wanted to do sooner than the December deadline, so they were trying to get it done sooner. And it's clearly not been possible because it's a piece of work they're sort of undertaking at the moment, so it's clearly still going from October 31st deadline into November. However, I've got no concerns about them achieving that December 2014 deadline, and then we go in January 15 to see what the outcome of that exercise was. So we're still within those sort of time scales, and all those time scales are identified.
Tailored it to Wirral Council's requirements, and we had two different posters printed. not giving personal information out to organisations or people before verifying their credentials. So it has a hyperlink to Action Board websites and also to their online reporting. So during the week, we have positive feedback from employees and managers about the posters and also the internet stories. And what we're looking to do in the future is to run a public campaign, which will again involve the same colleagues and also will be in collaboration with a few of their society colleagues. For this campaign, we're going to look at using Stoke Compliance Council's Spot the Cheater campaign. So it's got the distinctive image of the cheater on, to get across the campaign's hard-hitting message and prompt local people to report suspected fraudulent activity. Stoke were actually judged top in the 2010 Fraud Awareness Awards for its cheater campaign. It has been adopted by many other authorities. So during 2015, we'll be undertaking further awareness activities and targeted work, again in collaboration with other Mersey region authorities. And hopefully we'll continue to raise the profile of fraud within Wirral, you know, with your support.
So, of course, you talk about people benefits, etc., and support. work was accepted by the Superintendent on the Task Force Big Committee panel. Government District Board, that sort of service and that comparison will continue in these authors as time goes on. So it's still out there. But in terms of the detail of the case, as I say, it's sometimes helpful for authors to understand exactly how the frauds were committed and can you take them elsewhere. And you know, the one that was on the agenda tonight about, so that was being on the agenda before, about paper fraud was replicated significantly across the country. And in the group of clients that I've looked after, at least four of them have been subject to that type of fraud, which is to the ingenious because it's out there for the moment and it needs to replicate in the future.
Just add to that, we have a fairly significant database of material that we access, not least as my colleague mentioned that the information of my value of commission, the protect the public purse publication is a particularly useful one that we need to sort of have along. So both SIPA and the IA certainly also produce sort of comparative statistical data that I want to include.
item 5 is the final report on 2013 14 financial year. We'll be following my presentation before the annual audit letter. Just want to compliment that. Just to give you an update, the last audit was on the 2nd of September. At that stage, we were waiting to find what it did in relation to the accounts. That was all done. The accounts were then published on the 5th of September, which is the due date of the accounts being completed to be revised as far as scales. In that time, we also got a copy of the final audit opinion, which is attached to the Appendix A, which, as I said before, gave us an unqualified final audit opinion. And it also made comments as well about value completed. It's known as what we call 2012-13 was an adverse opinion. 13-14 was not an adverse opinion, it's a favourable opinion. Again, it's good news. As part of that, there's an action plan to have the actual thing to take to make further improvements, and that was released under Appendix B. The court went to Cavendish in October time, which agreed to Cavendish the board committee to keep an oversight of the actions and the back of the action plan. So I'm proposing the periodic updates here. There's also not progress being made. Within that initiative, there are a couple of names mentioned. Obviously, the names will now change, given the change in the council over the recent few weeks. The actions will still be progressed. One of the actions on there was, of course, the capacity of the financial services division. Clearly, that now becomes a bit more of an issue going forward. Make sure members can do our work to make sure we can make the accounts again for 2015 tax gains. The early days of the next year's change, of course, we will come on in July next year. So you can see the accounts on an informal discussion, briefing session. Happy to say the question. Questions?
Still realising that you can't go in at once, but it's a choice of perhaps in fact it will take to where we are now and sort of some of the improvements that we need to make. That was what I was going to say, pilot, I'm happy to take questions. Sorry.
Yeah. Just
a
matter of curiosity,
sure, or Yeah, there's a bit of an increase of 2.5. We haven't had a reaction from that at the kind of running cost of effect, because so it's slight technical, but because there's always been some gap between the running cost of claims and the cost of claims each year,
yeah,
and the self-insured adequate exposure, because it's supposed to give us some category of the water, so the insurers don't have to pay more than the claims. When we had a look in detail at our running cost of claims, we actually worked out that 2.5 million, which is what it was, was actually not that far away from the running cost, which is about just under 2 million. So we thought it would be very sort of like that, but it's actually not unreasonable for that to move to the sort of near the figure that the insurers were suggesting, but not quite as much. So as part of the overall negotiations, we said 3% of that is not acceptable, but we recognised appropriately by CSG. doesn't work very well in black and white, I'd have to say. The risk matrix, which is disclosed on page 75, is basically a graphical representation of the scores that have been given for the impact on the management of each of the corporate risks. It's basically, and all of that information is obviously really detailed and registered as well, but the idea of the matrix is to sort of give you a kind of at a glance view of which of the risks are the most significant and how many of them are, for example, in the red category. Some kind of narrative box report would be helpful. And next time I do that, actually, obviously, I'll make sure that that's enough, that that's the purpose of the refusing the table and the case.
Yeah, I was looking at the corporate risk on page 73. Non-financial, what they do within inclusive, and it seems to have a high risk factor there. It says a recent decision arising from the proposal to increase the income and chief effectives salary by sort of half an hour. Does that include the equation?
It has actually been that way for quite some time. It is as you can
said about, I mean, the danger of cuts is the balance of that, yes. To discuss it, so that's what we're talking about. As I say, you might not then end up with whatever is 31, which you might end up with actually 50, which some of them being quite specific, or maybe slightly different. But that would potentially then become more fluid as the risk is, if you like, shaken out of things, and then we can understand more clearly what is risky. I mean, for example, I was talking about what path was made on to push all our ways be at a risk. If we mean that there's a danger that, you know, the Chancellor will pick up the phone to Jeffrey, who cares? But if we say that's the risk, then I'd say it. Do you know what I mean? But I say I'm not going into that for any particular format, but we've got to have a format where the specific risk is identified. And then the general heading is all in the same place. It just looks slightly massive than if we're having to do as you make it.
So that's what we're doing. You're all really short, and you didn't get the phone for a new.
Okay, check. That's so good.
Thank you.